Drahí priatelia, po veľmi dlhej dobe je toto prvá relácia, kedy za oknami nášho štúdia je konečne nádherné a teplé jarné počasie, na ktoré sme dlho čakali. Hi everyone. After a long time, this is the first show where or when we are here in our tiny little studio in Manhattan. Behind the windows, there's finally this wonderful warm spring weather that we've been expecting for such a long time. Takže vonku ľudia sa z tohto počasia radujú a my sme tu v štúdiu, ale tiež sa radujeme, pretože vám opäť môžeme priniesť inšpiratívny príbeh a vzácneho hostia. So people out there are happy about that. They're going for a walk and enjoying the weather, and we are here in the studio, but we are also happy about that because that gives us a chance to bring you or present you another interesting life story and another valued guest, ktorým dnes je, who is today, Eduardo Andino. Welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Ďakujem, som rád, že tu môžem byť. Eduardo, a predtým, ako sa pustíme do predstavovania projektu, ktorému sa venuješ, alebo môžeme povedať, že to je aj tvoja práca, trošku vždy predstavíme ten osobný život, takže popri mene, ktoré som povedala, sa rovno spýtam možno na tvoje korene, odkiaľ pochádzaš. So before we start speaking about the project of yours, or I can actually say also the job of yours, we're going to speak a little more about your personal life, and when I pronounce your name, that leads me to a question of your roots and where do you come from?
Absolutely. So great to be here. Like I said, grew up here in New York. Love the city. Grew up in Jackson Heights, which is a neighborhood in the borough of Queens. Wonderful place to grow up. There's people from all parts of the world. You can eat great food from so many places. You can learn about people and their background. I myself am primarily of Puerto Rican family, although I also have a grandmother who was born in Rome and is Italian, and my grandparents met during the war, World War II, and my grandfather was stationed in Italy, and she came back home and to the U.S. and raised her family here.
Mm-hmm. So you do have connection to Europe, where so many of our viewers are right now.
Absolutely, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Ja, ako som už povedal, sa veľmi teším, že tu môžem dnes byť s vami. Narodil som sa teda v New Yorku a pochádzam z časti, alebo teda vyrastal som v časti s názvom Jackson Heights, ktorá je súčasťou Queens. A je to teda také prostredie, v ktorom som od začiatku odmala stretával mnoho národností, mal som šancu ochutnať mnoho vynikajúcich kuchyň, alebo teda áno, rôznych národných kuchyň. A teda som si obľúbil nielen jedlo, ale aj ľudí, popri ktorých som vyrastal. Osobne moje korene pochádzajú z Puerto Rica, ale takisto mám vlastne starú mamu, alebo mal som starú mamu, ktorá pochádzala z Talianska. Spolu s mojim starým otcom sa stretli počas vojny v Ríme, takže to je také trochu moje pozadie. No a predtým, ako sa môjho hostia spýtam ďalšiu otázku, vám chcem tiež povedať, že sa teším, že opäť môžete reagovať, pretože sme spojení naživo, takže na obrazovkách budete viackrát vidieť naše kontakty a my potom v závere relácie, ak pošlete nejaké otázky alebo podnety, tak ich určite sa pokúsime všetky prečítať. So before I speak to you again, I would like to speak to you first and tell you that I'm very excited that you can react because we are connected live again. So you will see the contact information on the screens several times during the show and towards the end of the show, we'll try to definitely react to all of your comments or suggestions. Ako tvoj životný príbeh pokračoval z Jackson Heights? Ja viem, že ty si sa presúval na viaceré miesta a čo to so sebou prinášalo. So, how did your life story continue? I know that from Jackson Heights, there you came to several different places. And what was it like?
Absolutely. So, you know, because I'm here, we're sharing our Catholic faith on this show. I was at a Jesuit high school in the city called Regis, and in many ways I owe to that school kind of my coming to take more seriously my faith. The things we studied, the things we did made me think more seriously, there's so much here, so much richness in the church's theology, its philosophy. And that was sort of a first real big step in my journey towards taking my faith seriously. Mm-hmm. After that, continued on to Yale University for my undergraduate studies and did a master's in theology at Notre Dame, mm-hmm. After which I, sort of embarked in my career and has brought me to the present day.
Wonderful. So we'll speak about both of the schools a little more in detail. Ja som teda vyštudoval, sedím tu s vami v štúdiu preto, že zdieľame spolu katolickú vieru a to máme spoločné a ja tú svoju katolickú vieru alebo také jej prehlbenie som za to vďačný najmä svojej strednej škole, ktorá bola teda vedená jezuitmi a práve toto prostredie ma naozaj priviedlo do mojej viery tak hlbšie. Uvedomil som si, aké má bohatstvo, aké bohatstvo v sebe skrýva a ako sa toto bohatstvo dá objavovať, takže určite to zanechalo na mne veľký dopad a aj vďaka tomu som sa nakoniec rozhodol i študovať teda najskôr na Univerzitu Yale a potom na Univerzitu Notre Dame. No a presne o týchto univerzitách sa trochu porozprávame, lebo to je zaujímavá téma. So, an interesting topic, the universities, let's talk about them separately. What was Yale like?
Yale was a wonderful experience. Both of my parents had been there before me, and so in many ways going there was a sense of you know, being able to take part in this family history, this family tradition. But it was really such a wonderful time of intellectual discovery in the midst of my courses. Faith discovery, as I mentioned, my faith really started to take off before I went to college. And the wonderful thing there was being blessed with some very good mentors as professors who took a real interest in forming us as students and helping us to navigate our thinking. Of course, Yale being such a secular campus in many ways, there was some fun times sort of rattling the cages a little bit and challenging the campus culture. But in many ways, it makes you really choose how you want to live your life. If you come as a Catholic to Yale, you sort of realize I have real definite choices to make between sort of a mainstream life and a more deliberate choice. Mm-hmm.
Pre mňa to bolo vzácne aj v tom, že na Univerzite Yale teda predo mnou študovali aj obaja moji rodičia, takže som sa tešil, že môžem v takejto aj rodinnej tradícii pokračovať. A bol to naozaj fantastický čas, ktorý som si veľmi vychutnal. Treba však ale poznamenať, že v dnešnej dobe je táto univerzita veľmi sekulárna, takže keď sa tam dostanete ako katolík, tak naozaj vás to tak preskúša vo vašej viere a preskúša v tom rozhodnutí, že či chcete ísť tým mainstreamom takzvaným, ale teda hlavným prúdom toho, ako tam ľudia žijú a čomu veria, alebo sa teda rozhodnete držať svojej viery a potom stretnete priateľov alebo tých ľudí a ste taká menšia skupinka, ktorá teda sa snaží byť verná tomu, čomu verí a niekedy to bolo zaujímavé ako keby provokovať tých iných a tým, čomu veríme v takom tom dobrom zmysle, ale určite to teda ovplyvnilo to, ako som sa vo svojej viere prehlbilo, pretože som vlastne si ju na tejto univerzite potreboval udržať. To je trochu taký smutný príbeh v zmysle, že tak ako aspoň ja viem, tak táto univerzita začínala práve založená na náboženských princípoch. Čo sa stalo? So that's a little bit of a sad story because as far as I know, this university started or was based on religious, religious people and foundation. What happened?
It's a long story. It's, you know, like many of the Ivy League schools, many American universities, it was founded as basically a seminary, a place to train churchmen. They were not predominantly Catholic in the United States, but there was, you know, seminaries for different Protestant denominations, and there's a very strong understanding that the life of the mind and the life of faith went together for effective preaching, for effective thinking about the reality of faith. And you know, the story of how the universities became so secular, you know, books are written about it. It's a long story, but it's in many ways was fascinating the time that I was there, because you could really see such an acceleration in sort of a progressive mentality. There were things that had to be sort of whispered when I was a freshman, a first year student, whereas when I was a senior, these things were being said open and publicly and very aggressively. And if you didn't agree with them, you were liable to be called, a bigot or saying that you were not a nice person, yeah, or things like this. Mm-hmm. So it was fascinating to view just the changes during the time that I was there. Mm-hmm.
Je to veľmi dlhý príbeh, samozrejme, a celý ten proces, ako sa to dialo, bolo o tom napísaných mnoho kníh, takže by sa dalo rozprávať dlho, ale v princípe treba poznamenať, že všetky vlastne, alebo takmer všetky univerzity, ktoré sú dnes prominentné v USA, začínali v podstate ako semináre. A nebolo to vždy v USA práve katolícka viera, ale bola to protestantská viera a teda kresťanská viera, ktorá, na základe ktorej sa tieto univerzity zakladali a vlastne aj pokračovali v tom, na čom boli založené. A bolo neuveriteľne zaujímavé pre mňa už len v mojich štúdiách sledovať to, ako postupuje to progresívne zmýšľanie a vyjadrovanie. A keď som bol v prvom ročníku, o niektorých veciach sa len šepkalo a nemohlo sa o nich hovoriť nahlas. Avšak už vlastne, keď som bol v záverečnom ročníku, tak už sa o nich hovorilo nielen nahlas, ale aj veľmi takým agresívnym spôsobom, kedy vlastne, ak ste boli proti týmto progresívnym názorom, tak ste nezapadali a boli ste nazvaní ako, že ste bigotní a že teda nejdete s dobou. Takže už ja som to mohol v priebehu tých mojich pár rokov, čo som bol tam, a sledovať. Potom pre teba musela byť asi zmena, keď si prešiel na Univerzitu Notre Dame. So I guess there was a huge change for you when you started studying at the second university, which is the Notre Dame one.
Absolutely. So Notre Dame, of course, very, very renowned, you know, Catholic university here in the United States, very rich history. And I really wanted an opportunity to study theology in a Catholic context. At Yale, you had an excellent opportunity to do religious studies at the Divinity School. You know, you could get very good classes on St. Augustine and theology and all sorts of very good things. But really, I was looking for a truly deeply Catholic context in which to do these studies, and I would say that at Notre Dame I had a really wonderful experience doing that, and especially focusing on the patristics, so the study of the early fathers of the church in Latin and Greek. Mm-hmm.
Áno, táto univerzita má bohatú katolícku tradíciu v tejto krajine a ja, hoci na univerzite Yale, som mal príležitosť študovať aj rôzne predmety náboženského charakteru. Dalo sa študovať svätý Augustín alebo svätý Tomáš Akvínsky a teda mnohé zaujímavé predmety, ale ja som túžil po takom rízo-katolíckom vzdelávaní, ktoré teda práve táto Notre-Dameská univerzita poskytuje. Chcel som sa viacej zakoreniť práve v tej katolíckej teológii, takže naozaj potom to bola pre mňa taká zmena, že som mohol študovať práve takto. No, pre predstavu našich divákov je to aj asi nádherné prostredie, kde sa dá študovať. Ten kampus, pokiaľ viem, je nielen obrovský, ale aj taký majestátny. So, just for our viewers, as far as I know, it's also a beautiful place to study. I know that the campus is kind of huge and majestic.
Absolutely. So when you first drive into Notre Dame through the main street there, it's a breathtaking sight. I mean, you've got beautiful streets. There's the cemetery, which of course, you know, cemetery is always a sad place, but there's something beautiful and majestic mm-hmm. about it as well. Seeing these generations of the priests who have served at Notre Dame being buried there, the Holy Cross priests is the order. Mm-hmm. The basilica on campus is absolutely beautiful, majestic place to have mass if you've ever been there. And there's, of course, a beautiful lake in the back of the campus where you can go and take walks when you need a break from the hard study. And it's just such a beautiful place to meditate and, mm-hmm. and to take in the beauty of nature.
Sounds wonderful. Áno, určite, keď vchádzate do kampusu tejto univerzity, tak už ten prvý pohľad, ktorý sa vám naskytne, je naozaj dých vyrážajúci a je tam naozaj teda aj krásna bazilika. Pri príchode teda ešte môžete zhliadnúť aj cintorín, pričom cintorín je vždy teda aj miesto, ktoré vyvoláva smútok, ale na druhej strane aj v niečom veľmi také posvetné miesto. Takže vidieť tam vlastne, mať šancu vidieť, koľko katolických kňazov, ktorí učili na tejto univerzite a venovali tomu celý svoj život, je tam pochovaných, je to teda rehoľa Svätého Kríža. A takisto je tam obrovská krásna bazilika, v ktorej je nádherné ísť na svätú omšu a okrem toho je tam aj krásne jazero, takže keď ste taký už prepracovaní zo všetkého toho ťažkého štúdia, tak môžete ísť na prechádzku a je to krásne miesto na meditovanie a na také stíšenie sa. Ešte raz vás pozbudzujem, aby ste sa zapojili do našej relácie a poslali nám buď otázky alebo nejaké podnety. So one more time, I would like to tell you if you feel like sending us any questions or just suggestions or just greetings to my wonderful guests, you can do so, you have the contact information there. Keby si mal vyzdvihnúť takú možno najkrajšiu skúsenosť počas tvojich štúdií alebo niečo najvzácnejšie, čo si odniesol, čo by to bolo? So if you were asked for maybe the nicest experience from all the years of your studying, what would it be?
Oh my goodness, that's very, very
it's a
challenging.
Difficult question,
well,
right?
I would say, for one, meeting my wife mm-hmm. as an undergraduate student mm-hmm. at Yale. You know, nothing can beat that. I think in many ways, and especially the community of friends that we grew up with there and had there. It was just a very special time. All of us, in our own ways, were growing in our faith together, coming from different backgrounds, but really sharing that, I think, mm-hmm. was such a such a special time. I think, you know, one of the things that I realized in graduate school, and that I think many realize, is nothing replaces really the sense of community life that you have in the United States as an undergraduate student. It mm-hmm. really is sort of a special time of intellectual growth being done with your peers, and there's something irreplaceable about that.
Sounds wonderful. Je to veľmi ťažká otázka, ale asi musím povedať, že samozrejme nič neprekoná to, že práve počas svojich štúdií na Yale univerzite som stretol svoju manželku, ale takisto chcem vyzdvihnúť ešte raz tú skupinu priateľov, ktorých som si tam vybudovala, s ktorými sme sa modlili, s ktorými sme sa vzdelávali. Myslím si, že to je jedna z takých najkrajších príležitostí, ktoré ako študent máte, že vlastne sa venujete nielen štúdiam, ale aj naozaj budovaniu takej malej, ale pevnej komunity, ktorá vás proste drží a cez tie štúdie vás potom prenesie, takže to je určite jeden z najkrajších zážitkov. No a ja verím, že spomenieme ešte viacre, nielen zážitky, ale teda už aj tvoje pracovné skúsenosti, ale predtým si dáme krátku pauzu. So I believe we are going to mention more nice experiences, but also your job experience. But before that, we're going to take a short break and we'll see you in a few minutes.
Happy day.
Opäť sme naspäť v štúdiu na Manhattane s mojim vzácnym hosťom, ktorým dnes je Eduardo Andino. A o čom ešte všetkom budeme rozprávať, vás už čaká o pár sekúnd. So we're back in our studio in Manhattan with my guest. Today it is Eduardo Andino and we're going to speak about more interesting things in a few seconds. Ale práve teraz sa veľmi teším z toho, že niektorí z vás reagovali a prišli nám otázky, ktoré teraz prečítam. But before we do that, I'm going to read your questions. We're very excited that you react. Aké aktivity majú katolíckí študenti v rámci študentského života na univerzite? Majú tiež stretká, mládežnícke omše alebo pastoračné centrum? Píše Juraj. So the first question is, what kind of activities do Catholic students have during their studies at the university? Do they have like small prayer groups or young adult masses or some center for them?
Absolutely. There were a lot of resources. In fact, there's the campus chaplaincy for Catholic students is very good. They have a nice center where people go and study. They have a great library, and of course, Mass is offered there. There are Bible studies. A group of us would do the Rosary mm-hmm. and night prayer from the office Mass of the hours together when we were there on weeknights. And there's also a fantastic church, St. Mary's, which is not affiliated with the campus, but is run by the Dominican fathers there who really were extraordinary and formative men for me in my time there. There's also, of course, the pro-life group on campus. There's other activities like that. There's the Yale Political Union, which wasn't Catholic, but a lot of Catholics would join and enjoyed taking part in the political and cultural mm-hmm. debates.
Mm-hmm. Sounds very, very rich.
Yes.
Určite mali sme tam veľmi veľa zdrojov, z ktorých sme mohli čerpať a stretávali sme sa spolu. Je tam vlastne kapláni, ktorí sú pridelení tejto univerzite, aby sa venovali študentom, tak ako je to vlastne na Slovensku. A takisto sme boli rôzne biblické skupinky. Ja s mojou skupinkou, my sme sa modlievali rúženec, alebo teda aj vešpery počas týždňa spolu, ako teda komunita mala. Ale takisto okrem kostola, ktorý sa nachádza tam, sú tam poblíž aj dominikáni, ktorí veľmi ovplyvnili aj môj duchovný život. Nielen počas teda štúdií, ale aj ďalej v živote. Takže naozaj tých príležitostí tam bolo viacej. Potom tam bolo jedno stretko, ktoré bolo možno zamerané viac na politické debaty, ale bolo tam aj veľa katolíkov. Samozrejme, netreba vynechať aj hnutie za život, ktoré bolo veľmi aktívne. A spomínajúc debaty, prišla ešte otázka, či sú medzi študentami bežné debaty o Bohu, prípadne o rozdieloch medzi cirkvami. Is it typical for students to talk about God and to debate that? Do they sometimes discuss the differences between churches?
Absolutely, and I think there was a rich life of debate. There's actually, for such a secular campus, lots of religious student groups, Protestant and Catholic, but obviously beyond that as well. Me and one of my good friends, he was Protestant, and we would spend a lot of time debating, and it could get heated, but it was also a lot of fun and very mm-hmm. educational. Mm-hmm.
Určite áno, práve takéto debaty sa na kampuse odohrávajú často, veľa tam bolo aj takých ako keby diskusných skupín, do ktorých sa dalo zapojiť. I ja osobne som mal priateľa protestanta, s ktorým sme veľakrát diskutovali a niekedy sa možno tie diskusie aj stali také palčivejšie, ale vždy to bolo aj veľa zábavy a mali sme v takom rešpekte sme sa vždy dokázali o tom rozprávať. Aké akcie pre mladých katolíkov sú v New Yorku iné ako na Slovensku? So there's a question about what kind of events are there for young Catholics here in New York that are different to Slovakia. I don't think you can compare it to Slovakia, but maybe we can leave this question to the very end of the show.
Sure.
Túto otázku by sme si nechali, ak vyjde čas nakoniec, ak sa nenahnevate, lebo sme to spomínali vo viacerých reláciách predtým, takže to môžete určite nájsť v archíve. A ja nechcem preskočiť to, kvôli čomu náš dnešný host prišiel, takže ďakujem za pochopenie. So we already mentioned the events in other shows with other guests, and I would like to start with something, and this is going to sound ironic, because we're going to speak about first things, and we didn't start the show with that. So práve teraz to môže vyznieť trochu ironicky, pretože téma, o ktorej ideme rozprávať, sa nazýva prvé veci, alebo možno by sa dalo povedať aj prvotné veci, no a my sme nimi reláciu nezačali, ale dostávame sa k tomu teraz. Takže čo to prosím ťa je a aká je tvoja úloha v prvých alebo prvotných veciach? So what is it? First things, and what's your role in that, please?
First Things is a journal of religion and public life. It's mm-hmm. been around since March of 1990, so almost 30 years now. It is a journal that comes out 10 times per year, has a subscription circulation of about 28,000, with about 4 million online viewers annually. Mm-hmm. So it quite a large circulation. The topic, as I said, is religion and public life. And it was founded by a Catholic priest, Father Richard John Newhouse, whose idea with the magazine was to engage in public debate about secularism. Secularism was very strong current in some parts of American society in the early 90s, and it sought to say that faith should play no role in our public discussions. It's a private matter, keep it at home. And he said, well, no, faith is very important in our public life. It grounds our democracy. It grounds our sense that each person has worth, has dignity. Each person's vote matters because each person matters. And so he said, we can't afford to sweep faith away from public life. It must be strong in informing our public institutions and public culture if we're to continue having the good things that we have.
Je to časopis, ktorý už funguje vyše 30 rokov, bol založený v roku 1990 v marci a vlastne založil ho kňaz Richard John, alebo Richard, Richard Jan Newhouse, keď prekladáme aj mená. A teda on ho založil práve preto, že v danom čase bol sekularizmus veľmi výrazný na Slovensku, ja už som v hlave na Slovensku, tu v USA bol sekularizmus veľmi výrazný a ten sekularizmus sa snažil ľuďom povedať, že viera nepatrí do verejného života a aj tento časopis je vlastne o náboženstve a verejnom živote, alebo aj o role náboženstva vo verejnom živote. Takže vlastne vychádza 10 krát do roka, príjma ho asi 28,000 ľudí, ale vyše 4 milióny ľudí ho čítajú teda aj online, také sú čísla, čiže naozaj to má dosť veľký dosah na ľudí. A ako tento kňaz vlastne naznačil, alebo čo bol jeho hlavný cieľ, tak to je cieľom toho časopisu dodnes, povedať, že nie, viera má veľmi dôležitú úlohu v našich životoch a nielen v životoch osobných, ale aj v spoločenskom rozmere. Naša viera je niečo, na čom veľká časť demokracie bola vybudovaná, takže bola by veľká chyba zamiesť ju pod koberec a nevenovať sa jej. Ako si sa ty k niečomu takémuto, prosím ťa, dostal? So what was your journey to become part of this?
It's very, very circuitous journey. I first reached out to Rusty Reno, who is the current editor of First Things, when I was a college student. And as I mentioned, I did my master's in theology. So I asked him, I said, you know, Rusty, where should I look? Which programs are the best? Which should I apply to? That led to a conversation. We met in person, and ever since we had stayed in touch. And then finally, just a couple of years ago, when he decided it was time to hire somebody for the position that I occupy, he said, "Well, why don't you come on over to First Things and do this for us."
What's his name one more time, please?
Rusty Reno.
Rusty Reno, OK. Takže skontaktoval som sa s človekom, ktorého menuje Rusty Reno a on je vlastne editorom, hlavným editorom tohto časopisu. Chcel som sa s ním skontaktovať preto, aby som sa ho spýtal, ako ďalej v živote, aké sú dobré programy, ktorým by som sa mohol venovať. Vlastne sme sa stretli, odtedy sme zostali v kontakte a v čase, kedy on chcel zaplniť tú pozíciu, ktorú teraz zaplňam, alebo teda ktorej sa venujem práve ja, tak ma kontaktoval a poprosil ma, že či by som teda nechcel, alebo dal mi takú ponuku, a či by som nechcel pracovať práve pre tento časopis. No a aby sme približili, trošku sme dali takú definíciu, že čomu sa ten časopis venuje, ale keby sme to chceli divákom približiť a povedať, aké sú teda také témy, tak čo by to bolo? So we said a little bit about like the basic definition of the magazine, but if we wanted people who are watching us understand better, so what are the topics? What do you guys write about?
Today a lot of our attention has gone to sort of new things that we're seeing in our public culture and in our politics. One of the topics that is sweeping both in the US and Europe and throughout the West is this idea of populism. So you see in the United States we have Donald Trump winning the election, and in England you have Brexit, the popular vote to secede from the EU.
We could speak about Slovakia too.
Yes, almost everywhere. France, Germany, the Netherlands, anywhere you look, it's happening. And so part of what we've tried to do is, I think there's been a lot of very strong reactions, and we've tried to take a step back and say, well, why is this happening? Instead of simply denouncing outright, let's stop and let's try to understand it. And that's one of the big topics that has occupied our time, and trying to, you know, in light of the changes happening with populism, in light of the grievances that people have, trying to formulate a new politics and cultural program for our time that meets those needs in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. Určite jednou z najväčších tém, ktorým sa momentálne venujeme, ako všeobecne môžem povedať, že ten časopis reaguje na dôležité zmeny v spoločnosti a to, čo sa momentálne odohráva naskrz nielen celou Amerikou, ale aj Európou a ako som ja spomenula, určite aj na Slovensku vieme, o čom to je, je práve populizmus, ktorý narastá a ktorý je veľmi úspešný a my namiesto toho, aby sme na ne nejakým spôsobom útočili, sme sa rozhodli ako keby podstúpiť a pohliadnúť na tento populizmus, na tento fenomén, prečo sa to deje a prečo je vlastne úspešný. Takže tomuto sa určite venujeme v našom časopise veľmi veľa času momentálne, lebo je to taká aktuálna téma. Tak prečo sa to deje? So why is it happening?
That's a great question. So one of the fundamental aspects that we see is since around the end of the World War II, you have this very strong program towards the idea of the open society. You know, you everything that seems closed-minded in some way or not, you know, not open to change, not open to you know, finding something new is considered reactionary in some way or blocking progress. Mm-hmm. And so this theme of openness has been very good in many aspects of our society, but in some aspects it has caused damage. For example, some institutions that are very important and that we need as humans are the family. We need to have a sense of stability and a sense of a family. But what does the progressivism tell us? That, you know, the family is a social construct, that it doesn't exist. It's not real. It's the patriarchy. You know, same thing with church, with faith. It's extremely important for people. But what is the answer is that, oh, faith isn't real. It's your imagination. It's, you know, these scared people that are clinging to their guns and to their Bible. and finally, the sense of being a people, of being a nation, of having a country and a heritage that you're proud of. You know, the progressive side will tell us that that's dangerous. If you're too proud of your country, if you love your heritage too much, you could turn violent. Nationalism mm-hmm. can do bad things. And so it's trying to find ways to articulate these are real goods and they need a place in human life. And mm-hmm. I think that's what you really see at the core of populism, is mm-hmm. people are reacting and saying, well, wait a minute, faith, family, and country matter, and you can't mm-hmm. just tell us that they don't.
Mm-hmm. But are you trying to say that populists say this?
I think that this is what you see at the core mm-hmm. of populism. Okay. So there's mm-hmm. a lot of reaction to the liberal and progressive program, mm-hmm. and it doesn't always articulate it. Mm-hmm. But I think these are the reasons at core why people are restless okay. with the program, that it's going too strongly against these aspects mm-hmm. of a healthy mm-hmm. human culture.
So after I interpret, I'm going to ask you what are the negatives or the dangers of populism too. Populizmus, teda snažíme sa prísť na to, prečo sa to deje a môžeme povedať, že už po druhej svetovej vojne sa začal vyvíjať taký trend, ktorý bol v podstate, svojej podstate dobrý, ale samozrejme sa zase zvrtol do nie najlepšieho. A to bolo to, že všetko, čo nie je v angličtine povedia open-minded, keď máte vlastne ako keby ste otvorení novým nápadom, novým ideám, novým trendom. Takže vlastne začalo sa vyvíjať ako keby taká myšlienka, že keď ste nie takto zmýšľajúci, keď nie ste otvorení každému novému nápadu, ktorý v spoločnosti sa snažia presadiť, tak vlastne ste nejaký spiatočnícky. No lenže začali sa presadzovať nápady, ktoré vlastne útočia na naše najväčšie stability, na našu najväčšiu oporu, povedali nám alebo hovoria nám, snažia sa nám povedať, že rodina nie je dôležitá, že to je výmysel, že to je patriarchát, že ju nepotrebujeme, že viera nie je dôležitá, že to je opäť sme si vymysleli, niečo projektujeme, je to len naša predstavivosť a podobne. Takže my si myslíme v našej redakcii a tomu sa aj venujeme, že v centre toho populizmu je práve to, že ľudia začínajú na to reagovať a hovoriť, že nie, 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 tieto veci sú dôležité pre náš život. No ale teraz je asi dôležité sa pozrieť aj na to, že čo v populizme ale zase nie je správne, sú. We should maybe speak also about what the dangers of populism are.
Absolutely. So I think to start, you know, you look at the liberal project following World War II, and it has lots of really important things. There were aspects of society that needed opening, that needed deconsolidation, needed change. You see the civil rights movement in the U.S. is a perfect example of cultural norms that where we benefited from those cultural norms being shaken up and being changed. I think viewed broadly with populism, one of the dangers is that it can be only reactionary and not have an aspect of knowing what it is that it's actually looking for. So it can have a sort of revolutionary impulse to it of, you know what you're against, but it's harder to articulate what you're actually for.
That's a very same principle with freedom. We try to be free from something, but we sometimes don't know what we want to be free for.
Absolutely.
Okay. Určite treba spomenúť teda o oba aspekty populizmu, a takže to, že začalo nejaké liberálne hnutie po vojne, bolo určite aj výhodou a prinieslo nám to mnoho pozitív. To netreba zabúdať a netreba to opomínať. Boli v rôzne časti spoločnosti a aspekty, kde bolo treba zmeniť zmýšľanie. V Amerike to bol aj boj za občianske práva, ktorý nám priniesol veľmi veľa pozitív. Takže naozaj treba vyzdvihnúť aj to pozitívne, čo sa s liberálnym smerom začalo šíriť. Avšak keď chceme hovoriť o tom, že čo je na populizme nebezpečné, určite je to aj to, že ten populizmus sa rozhodne ako keby na tieto dnes už hrozby reagovať, a tak reakčne až tak revolucionársky možno, ale pristihneme sa pri tom, že tí populisti vlastne reagujú len proti niečomu, ale neposkytujú vlastne ako keby konštruktívne riešenia do budúcnosti. Nevedia, za čo bojujú, vedia len proti čomu bojujú. Na čo ja som teda povedala, že tak je to aj so slobodou. Myslím si ale, že v posledných dvoch minútach relácie nemáme šancu ísť do konceptu slobody. To by bolo asi najdlhšie. I mentioned freedom, but unfortunately I think the last 2 minutes of the show there's no way to start mentioning freedom because it's too deep. Ale možno, že by sme sa mohli vrátiť tej otázke nášho diváka, a že čo je v New Yorku, možno ty nebudeš vedieť povedať, že iné, ale aké akcie pre mladých katolíkov teba oslovili. So maybe we could go back to what one of our viewers is asking. You might not be able to compare what is it like in Slovakia and here, but what are the events or groups or organizations that influenced you as a young Catholic?
Well, I would say that one of the great resources we have in New York is very good religious orders. So, you know, holy men and women who have given their life to God in different ways. I know you've had the Sisters of Life, for example, come and speak at the show here one time, and they're an example of, you know, great, happy, joyful, you know, sisters who are really on fire for the faith, and, you know, lots of people like to be around them and go to they have retreats, for example, for spring break that lots of young people go to. The Franciscan Friars of the Renewal, they put on a Catholic underground once a month, which is an opportunity for prayer, followed by a concert. And there, you know, like 800 people go every time. It's this beautiful opportunity to come in and be inspired by the friars, but also to realize how many families there are out there who are longing for God in the same way, and build community and solidarity with them.
Mm-hmm. V New Yorku môžem spomenúť, že takým najvzácnejším pokladom, aspoň z môjho pohľadu, je množstvo reholí svätých mužov a žien, ktorých stretávate a máte šancu stretávať. Napríklad Sestry života, ktoré organizujú mnoho duchovných podujatí, mnoho obnov pre mladých ľudí, ktorí sa ich veľmi radi zúčastňujú. Takisto Františkáni obnovy, ktorí raz za mesiac organizujú takú akciu, ktorá sa to nazýva, že Catholic Underground, a vlastne prichádza tam vyše 800 ľudí, ktorí túžia byť na adorácii, na modlitbe, a po nej vlastne je potom nasleduje koncert. Takže naozaj títo ľudia sú veľkým pozitívom a veľkou inšpiráciou pre rast vo viere. Takže oni môžu byť inšpiráciou, takisto ty si inšpiráciou, aj váš časopis, a ja ti veľmi pekne ďakujem, že si ho prišiel odprezentovať, a verím, že ľudia, ktorých to zaujalo, si ho vyhľadajú a môžu sa možno aj po anglicky, aj na Slovensku vzdelávať aj intelektuálne o viere a spoločnosti. So the religious orders are a great inspiration, but so are you. I thank you for coming to our show and talking about your magazine, and I'm sure people can find it online and get to know it a little better.
Firstthings.com.
Perfect. Thank you one more time.
Thank
very
you very much.
Ďakujem veľmi pekne aj vám za sledovanie. Tešíme sa, že ste s nami. Thank you very much too. Thank you for watching us. We're very happy about you being together with us.